Okay, class, good to see you again this week. This week we're going back to Argentina in the 1830s and 40s and to a time of great change and turmoil. And we are going to discuss a theme in Latin American history called civilization and barbarism. So let's begin. This is a theme running all the way through Latin American culture and civilization. It was first articulated by Domingo Faustino Sarmiento, a future president of Argentina, wrote a book in Argentina in 1845 called Facundo, Civilization or Barbary, Barbarism. This is my copy of the book that I'm actually rereading. Facundo, Civilization and Barbarism. Facundo Quiroga was a caudillo in Argentina. He wasn't the primary one. Juan Manuel de Rosas was the dictator of Argentina and the primary caudillo. The caudillo was a charismatic, some might say populist, military man that would take charge as a dictator because of his personal charm and his charisma. And in the aftermath, after the Wars of Independence, with the disappearance of the monarchy and some of the shakiness of the Catholic Church and its authority structure, there was an authority vacuum in most countries in Latin America. And into that vacuum stepped these strong men, or these caudillos. And Juan Manuel de Rosas and Facundo Quiroga were such strong men. Domingo Sarmiento was a liberal. He was a unitario, a Unitarian in the political sense. And he opposed Juan Manuel de Rosas, who was a federalist, federalista, who this can be a little confusing. In some countries, such as Colombia, the liberals were federalists and the conservatives were unitarios. But in Argentina, it was just the other way around. The unitarios were the liberals. They wanted a strong central government in Buenos Aires that was oriented towards trade and free markets and liberal values, laissez-faire, sophisticated civilization. Whereas the conservatives were in favor of the Catholic Church, they were pro-military, and they wanted to keep Argentina divided into regions or provincias, and they wanted to avoid a unitary Argentine state. And from about 1831 through 1852, the Federalistas, conservatives, were ascendant through Juan Manuel de Rosas, who took power and ruled as a dictator using fear tactics and terror. And Domingo Sarmiento and others of his friends from the liberal Unitario Party had to flee from Argentina to avoid being killed. And one of the ways that they criticized or fought back against the conservatives was by writing literature such as Facundo. So this book is a foundational book for Latin American political culture. Independence meant the ejection of the Catholic monarchy, the establishment of republican self-rule everywhere except Brazil. But this left some questions unanswered. What about the mestizos? What about Indios or Africans? How did they fit into the liberal Creole, white Creole order of Latin America? So independence was more about securing a privileged position for white Creoles than for all of Latin American society, and was characterized by near-feudal agrarian systems, racial divisions, and slavery. There were some exceptions to the rule. For example, Brazil continued with a monarchical system for almost 70 years under Dom Pedro I, and then later, and for about 60 years, Dom Pedro II, who were descended from the royal house of Bragança in Portugal. Chile also achieved harmony and stability in its political system, but these were the exceptions, not the rules. This is a picture of the second emperor, Dom Pedro II of Brazil. Military caudillos were strong authoritarian strongmen that took power and ruled autocratically. They bridged the gap between the upper and lower classes, and hence they were considered populists. In Argentina, you have Juan Manuel de Rosas. In Mexico, you have Antonio López de Santa Anna, who's famous for losing the battle in Texas against the Texans. And he was the one, the Mexican general in command of the Mexican troops that attacked the Alamo. In Paraguay, you had Francisco Solano López, who was the second or third dictator, but he was the one that was responsible for launching the War of the Triple Alliance, in which Paraguay suicidally fought against Brazil, Argentina, and Uruguay, almost to the destruction of its entire population. Economies were devastated by the wars of independence, and so the big issues of the day were, should these countries adopt centralism or federalism? This was Argentina in the 1820s. Also, Colombia was facing similar decisions. Rosas ruled Argentina with a reign of terror. His wife, oddly enough, was the head of La Mazorca, which is a terrorist organization dedicated to, it was also a spy organization dedicated to supporting his rule. There's a great film called Camila that was written and produced in Argentina, if you have a chance. It's a little hard to find, but it's in the library. True story about a young Argentine woman during the reign of Juan Manuel de Rosas, who was an independent thinker and got in some trouble. Argentina, the people of Rio de la Plata struggled among themselves based on regional loyalties. The Unitarios were primarily export-oriented landowners and merchants in Buenos Aires. They favored a unified secular nation with an economy based on free trade. They also sought to limit the influence of the church. In other words, they were in favor of separation of church and state. The Federalistas were primarily rural cattle and landowners who wanted independence from Buenos Aires, and they favored the Catholic Church and tradition. El Caudillo Juan Manuel de Rosas ruled from 1829 to 1852 in Buenos Aires. He was a great horseman. He was willing to get out and to camp out and to ride with his employees on his ranches. And so he won the loyalty of the gauchos and the mestizos. The Argentine cowboys, by demonstrating his toughness, but he kept power through terror and spies. I already mentioned the Mazorca. He led the Federalista Party, which was adopted the color red to describe their ideology, and his enemies were the liberal Unitarios, were blue, and they were forced into exile or death. Argentina was united after the defeat of Rosas under the Bartolomé Mitre, and then the second president of the unified Argentina was Domingo Faustino Sarmiento, the author of the book Facundo. It was in this context that Sarmiento wrote the book Facundo as a bitter attack on the Rosas regime, using the example of another caudillo, Facundo Quiroga. It upheld the values of civilization in the sophisticated urban center of Buenos Aires, which consciously imitated Europe. in contrast to the barbarism of the rural gauchos of the interior. Another book of a similar vein that is a classic in Latin American literature is El Matadero, translated as The Slaughterhouse by Esteban Echevarria. It was a crude attack on Rosas. Esteban Echevarria was a friend of Sarmiento's. It was satirical. You can get a copy in English on Kindle called The Slaughterhouse. The Rosas regime was the slaughterhouse in this satire. The butcher stands in for Rosas and his supporters are the vile, stinking laborers wallowing in filth and blood. One brave bull, which is described as stubborn as a Unitarian, resists the slaughter. And later, a real-life Unitarian shows up and dies in a fit of rage after he's being mistreated and harassed by the butcher and his crowd. Esteban Echevarria was considered the father of Romanticism in Latin America. Echevarria summed up his own values in 1837 in a book called Dogma Socialista. Although it's not socialism as we're accustomed to with Marx, but it's a kind of pre-Marx sociability. As a result of the writings of Sarmiento and Echevarria, the gaucho unfortunately came to be associated with barbarism, the gaucho being the Argentine cowboy. The legacy of the gaucho and barbarism. One can detect a certain admiration and Sarmiento for the gauchos despite his negative association of them with barbarism. Gauchesque writing, especially poetry, began to restore the image of the Argentine gaucho, somewhat like the 1950s Western movies did with Western cowboys in American culture. Jose Hernandez, another writer, wrote a classic called El Gaucho Martín Fierro in 1872. Which put the gaucho in a more sympathetic light. This is an inversion of the civilization versus barbarism ethic. Now the peaceful rural dweller is destroyed by the capricious central government. There's a picture of Jose Hernandez and his book Martín Fierro. In Brazilian Romanticism, it was a slightly different variation. Antonio Gonçalves Dias was Brazil's greatest romantic poet. He compiled a Tupi dictionary. In his poetry, Brazil is portrayed as a sleeping giant which will one day awake and surprise the world. The major romantic novelist of Brazil, José de Alencar, who wrote O Guarani in 1857, Iracema, which we'll talk more about next week, in 1865, a romantic tragedy offers a less promising vision. Here's a picture of Dias and Alencar. Doris Summer, in her book Foundational Fictions, wrote about novels with young lovers in this period of nation building in Latin America, and she posited a theory that it was a projection of nation building and a desire for national conciliation. This is playing off of the idea of Benedict Anderson, who just came up with the idea of imagined communities, that a nation is an imagined community with symbols that create symbolic meaning. So the Argentine José Mármol wrote Amalia, in 1851. Actually, he was in Montevideo. I didn't do that very clearly, but he lived right across from Buenos Aires. Amalia was a romantic novel about love between two young lovers. A Cuban by the name of Cirilo Villaverde wrote Cecilia Valdez in 1882 about forbidden love between a young white Creole, Cuban Creole, and a darker-skinned Cubana mulata, and obviously has some symbolic meaning in terms of uniting the Cuban nation between its African and European components. Jorge Isaacs of Colombia wrote Maria in 1867. Again, there's a theme in Maria of love between a young, wealthy, elite Colombian young man, an heir, who is in love with a young peasant girl who has indigenous blood named Maria, uniting the Colombian nation with its various ethnicities. Iracema is a similar book by Jose Alencar, set in Brazil, although it has a tragic ending. Instead of being able to unite, Iracema dies and leaves open the question of the possibility of transculturation, assimilation, or loss in Brazil. Turn to essentially regionalism, some major events that affected the development of literature and thinking in Latin America, especially around this idea of civilization and barbarism, begins with 1898 with the Spanish-American War, and then 1902, the construction of the Panama Canal after Theodore Roosevelt rather forcefully separated Panama from Colombia, the Colombian nation. And then in 1910, you have the Mexican Revolution. Actually, keep in mind that the Mexican Revolution happened before the Soviet Revolution, the Chinese Revolution. And so it was one of the great, early great revolutions of the 20th century. An Uruguayan author and thinker by the name of José Enrique Rodeau wrote a book called Ariel in 1900, which he modeled the main characters after the characters from Shakespeare's Tempest. Ariel represents wisdom, beauty, and spirituality, and is a stand-in for Latin America. Caliban is the gruff materialism and utilitarianism of North American capitalism. So as you might imagine, this is a book that's pretty critical of materialistic North Americans as opposed to the philosophical and more spiritual Latin Americans. And, of course, with the Mexican Revolution, several of the main characters in that revolution were Pancho Villa, seen seated in the center, and Emiliano Zapata to the right with the large sombrero. Some very heroic and dramatic characters. So Enrique Rodeau and other authors show growing preoccupation with Latin American identity in this period. Also, a Mexican wrote about the Mexican Revolution. Mariano Anzuela wrote Los de Abajo in 1916 in the midst of the Mexican Revolution. That translates to the underdogs, as well as work. It represents an early liberal novel and shows a popular revolution as a barbaric cataclysm that destroys civilization. So here is another liberal writer leaning towards the idea of civilization. And in this case, the Mexican Revolution and the violence that's unleashed represents barbarism. This is a picture of the English version, The Underdogs. So a century of war continued after the overthrow of Spain and the creation of independent republics. There was a war to overthrow Rosas in 1852 in Buenos Aires. Then there were 19 civil wars in the 18th century. I'm sorry, in the 19th century, in Colombia. There were civil wars in Central America among one another, and also with Mexico to break up the Mexican Empire and eventually to break up Los Estados Unidos de America Central. Originally, there was an intent to keep all the Central American nations together as the United States of Central America, which failed. And you ended up with independent countries, Nicaragua, Honduras, Guatemala, El Salvador. There were also interregional wars, such as the War of the Triple Alliance in 1864, roughly near the end of the U.S. Civil War. The War of the Triple Alliance was a suicidal war of Paraguay, which was primarily indigenous. And Francisco Solano, the caudillo, against Brazil, Argentina, and Uruguay. And the war continued for 6 long years, almost to the point of the absolute destruction of the male population of Paraguay. The War of the Pacific was between Chile and Bolivia. I believe Peru was also involved for a short period of time in 1879. And this resulted in Bolivia losing all of its access to the Pacific Ocean. There were also foreign wars. There was the Mexican-American War in 1846, in which Mexico lost a huge amount of territory to the United States. And there was the Mexican Civil War in 1857 between liberals and conservatives, which liberals won, resulting in conservatives inviting the French to send in an army and send in a monarch, Maximilian. And so after the Mexican Civil War, the Mexican Franco-Mexican War continues through 1867, in which the French attempted to set up an empire in the New World in Mexico. In the 1960s, we have something we'll talk more about next week called the Latin American boom period for literature. This was a period in the 1960s in which a number of novels achieved global recognition and success in Latin America. The Latin American literature actually became universalized and became appreciated in Europe as well as in the United States and other parts of the world. Alejo Carpentier, who was a Cuban writer who was predominant in the 1950s, called this Lo Real Maravilloso, the marvelous reality. Many of his novels show characteristics of magical realism in the 1950s. Another writer was Miguel Angel Asturias, who mixed indigenous themes with subjectivity. And finally, you have full-blown magical realism in the 1967. Gabriel Garcia Marquez of Colombia wrote Cien Años de Soledad, 100 Years of Solitude, and won the Nobel Prize for Literature. He was absolutely shocked when he won the Nobel Prize for Literature. He fully expected that it would have been Jorge Borges of Argentina who would have won. The impact of war was profound both politically and economically. There was constant warfare. Militarized society, it rubbed old ethnic and class divisions, making them even worse. A Peruvian author, Mario Vargas Llosa, wrote one of my personal favorite books, La Guerra del Fin del Mundo, translated in 1981 as The War of the End of the World. And it's based on a true story that was earlier written by Euclides da Cunha about the rebellion in the backlands in a period of Brazilian history between the empire and the Brazilian Republic, in which a spiritual prophet and teacher rises up and draws the marginalized and the poor to himself and ends up leading a rebellion in the backlands of Brazil that took 5 different attempts by Brazilian militias and armies to finally subdue them. The War of the End of the World. I highly recommend it. So the conclusion, the 19th century was very difficult. You had instability in Mexico, Argentina, and Colombia. Peru was a worst case scenario with 24 regime change and 30 presidents. In less than 100 years, or less than 80 years, it appears. There was a high participation for lower classes. Military provided upward mobility. Post-independence Latin America was difficult, but the common people had some control. And throughout this period, you saw this back-and-forth pendulum swing between this idea of civilization represented by Europe, by European history, sometimes by the United States, and a vision of barbarism, which would represent the popular classes, the indigenous people, those who had been enslaved. You see this tension between these two different themes. Vargas Llosa was similar to Sarmiento, after a full circle journey from 1845 to 1980, I think it was 1985 when Vargas Llosa published The War of the End of the Worlds, you see they're still talking about civilization versus barbarism. In the final book by Vargas Llosa, you see the Brazilian peasants and marginalized peoples, indigenous peoples, enslaved peoples following the Antonio the Counselor into forming a rebellion against the central government, which represents civilization, and into a suicidal war in the backlands. Vargas Llosa actually, in the tradition of a lot of other writers such as Mitre, Sarmiento, Gallegos, ran for the presidency of Peru in 1990. And unfortunately, he lost. And Alberto Fujimori, a descendant of Japanese immigrants and a populist, became the president of Peru in the midst of a terrorist uprising and became himself a caudillo. The debate about civilization versus barbarism continues in Latin America, something to keep your eye on and pay attention to as you read literature and as you study Latin American civilization. Thank you very much. Have a good week.